good evening, everybody. It's good to have you here. It's good to be in church. And Sunday evening is always my favorite service of the week. And what a joy to have Brother Mills. How many were stirred and challenged to the preaching this morning? Say amen. Amen. I know I was. And I think all of us need to reevaluate our vision of world missions. And we need to have a vision of every creature missions. Every single person's a soul. And every single person Christ died for. And that was great. And I appreciate all those who are here today. Let's stand together and take our hymn books and sing one of my wife's favorite hymns. Hymn number 42, Our Great Savior. Jesus, what a friend for sinners. Lover of my soul. Let's sing it out and think about these wonderful words. Sing to the Lord tonight. Worship the Lord. Here we go. Jesus, what a friend for sinners. Friends may fail me, foes assail me. Songs about the Lord Jesus Christ, and I don't know of another hymn that's more comforting than that song. And let's go to another good one. Let's go to page number 58. Isn't the love of Jesus something wonderful? And it is wonderful. It's indescribable, isn't it? And we can't explain it. We just praise God for it. And I'm glad he loved us, even though we're sinners. Amen?
Amen.
And died for our sins, and we praise his holy name for it. Let's sing out all three verses. Isn't the love of Jesus something wonderful?
There will never be a sweeter story, story of the Savior's love divine, love that brought him from the realms of glory, just to save a sinful soul like mine. Isn't the love of Jesus something wonderful, wonderful? Isn't the love of Jesus something wonderful? Wonderful it is. Amen. On the second, boundless as the universe around me, reaching to the farthest soul away, saving, keeping love it was that found me. That is why my heart can truly say, isn't the love of Jesus something wonderful? Something wonderful, wonderful it is.
All right, now hang up for just a moment. How many would say amen to the fact that we are recipients of God's love? Would you say amen to that? All right, now, how many would say that we love the Lord? Would you say amen to that?
Amen.
All right, so if we love the Lord, while the piano plays through, those who love the Lord, go shake someone's hand and tell them, I love the Lord. Amen? And if you don't love the Lord, just stay in your seat, Brother Doug. All right? But if you love the Lord, go tell someone you love the Lord and tell someone you love them and appreciate them. All right? Let's welcome one another tonight, and then we'll come back and sing that last verse. Page number 58 on the third, love beyond our human comprehending, love of God in Christ, how can it be? This will be my theme and never ending, great redeeming love of Calvary. Isn't the love of Jesus something wonderful, wonderful, wonderful? Oh, isn't the love of Jesus something wonderful, wonderful?
wonderful it is.
Amen. Good singing. And we're so glad that you're here. Looking forward to a great service. And we'll move the service along and give Brother Mills all the time that he needs tonight. But looking forward to what God has in store for us. Let's pray. And we will get right into the service. Heavenly Father, we love you and thank you for loving us. And we thank you for your great love to us. And we're so grateful that we can come back and be with one another tonight and assemble around the Word of God. And I pray that your Holy Spirit would move in our hearts and work and minister to us, Father, through the preaching of thy Word. I pray, Father, that each and every one of us would be willing to respond to whatever you instruct or lead or encourage us to do. And I pray, Father, that we would leave here differently than when we came in for your glory and honor. Bless every aspect of the service. Thank you for how you have ministered to us already through the singing. And I pray that you would continue to do so when we praise you for all things. In Jesus' name, amen. And amen. You may be seated. I think most everyone was here this morning, so I'm not going to rehash the announcements other than to say, remember this Wednesday, I saw a number of folks bringing some food in for the barrels. And that's awesome. And we, you know, Wednesday will be the final day where you can bring those things in. So if you can help us with that, please help us with those items. And like I said, on the table outside, all the items that we need, we still have some food that was left over from the last shipment, but the things that we do need are on that table. So I appreciate you all helping with that. And then the other thing is I need you all to sign up ASAP for our Memorial Day picnic Sunday, which is April 29th. What is it? May 29th. We're already done with April, aren't we? My soul. It goes by quick. May 29th. And looking forward to it. We always have a great time with that. And Brother Dave and I, we were scheming what kind of food to have. Of course, we've got three big picnics for the summer. You know, we'll have the Memorial Day, the Labor Day, and of course, 4th of July. But we're thinking about, you know, at some point in those picnic times, we're going to do a pig roast. And we're going to get ribs in there at some point, barbecue chicken, and of course, always hamburgers and hot dogs are the staples. But just trying to figure out what will be best for this first go around. And how many like pig roast? Would you raise your hand? Okay, yeah, it's really good. We've had it from Bringhurst once before, and it changed my life. Amen. And so we'll get those details. But if you could sign up, and that would be helpful for us to know how much food to plan for. The other thing I just wanted to mention quickly was I got a phone call from Brother Harvey tonight. Actually, Brother Paul DiMartino texted me, and then Brother Harvey called me. Brother Harvey's in Virtua Hospital right now. He was admitted yesterday, and I talked to him, and he's not in serious condition or anything like that, but they're doing some tests on him as well, and they're going to do one tomorrow, and he thinks he'll be able to go home probably tomorrow after they get this test done. So pray for Brother Harvey, if you would. I thought it was unusual that he wasn't here, but I talked to him last Saturday, and he says, Pastor, for the next couple weeks, I'll be busy. And he says, I know I won't be at church last Sunday, which he wasn't. And so when he wasn't here this morning, I just figured, well, he did tell me that he was going to be busy for the next couple of weeks. So pray for Brother Harvey. I'll get your question in just a minute. Pray for Brother Harvey, and you know, hopefully he'll be able to come home soon. What else was there? I think that's pretty much it. Let's go ahead and have the men come and help us with the offering. We do have a missions letter that we're going to read at the end of the service because one of the missionaries who's in India requested that we want it broad, you know, put it online. So we'll have that reading right at the conclusion of our service. Mr. Judson turning 9 years old tomorrow, and he's pretty excited about that. And Mr. Judson, would you lift your voice and ask the Lord to bless the giving tonight?
Thank you.
How many believe that we reap what we sow? We do. And sometimes that's good, and sometimes that's bad. And sometimes, and one thing is certain, we always reap more than we sow. So let's sing this good hymn, 538, Bringing in the Sheaves, Sowing in the Morning, Sowing Seeds of Kindness. And we reap what we sow. And so all of us need to be, and if that be true, then we need to be busy sowing, don't we? So you can remain seated. Let's sing the first and the last verse of this great hymn. Here we go. Sowing in the morning, sowing seeds of kindness, sowing in the noontide and the dewy eve, waiting for the harvest and the time of reaping. We shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves. We shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves. We shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves on the last, going forth with weeping, sowing for the Master. Spirit often grieves when our weeping's over. He will bid us welcome. We shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves. We shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves. We shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves.
Amen. Good singing tonight. And Brother John, we're glad you're here, and it's been a blessing having you with us and getting to know you a little bit better and hearing more about Help Ministries. And I really am excited about that ministry and excited about what the Lord is doing and how it helps a lot of national pastors. And my heart, I really do, more and more as I'm, the longer I'm in ministry, the more I see a great benefit to for us to try to connect with national pastors. And as Brother John had said this morning, they already know the language, they already like the food, and they're kind of miles ahead from people who are leaving their home to go over there and try to preach the gospel. Not that we don't need people to leave here and go preach the gospel, but I'm thankful for the pastors that are over there reaching their own people. We praise the Lord for that. Brother John, you're going to show a video. Do you want to do what we did this morning? Okay, I'll go ahead, and if you want to start.
Hour. As I mentioned before, I was three trips over to India. The first one was right in 2017, right after I joined Help Ministries and did a graduation, came back home. That was for about a week. And then I took another trip in 2018 and right around the month of November and was there for a month. And I met this man, Peter Thumai, who I showed you this morning in Sunday school, his church, and worked with him and preached in different places. And he has a college, a master's college. And I've been there twice now. I went last year, or 2020 rather, just before COVID hit. I got out of India just in time. I left in the end of January, and they started closing India in February. And I have a feeling if I didn't get out, I'd still be there. But there's one man that I met in both trips that he was a student at the time. His name is Rakesh Gupta. Rakesh is a Hindu that got saved. And he is now church planting up in Uttar Pradesh. He's working in a, he's graduated from the college, and he is working among a snake worshiping village. They worship the cobras. You ever see that picture where they have them in the basket? And you know, I never thought that was real. Do you know it's real? And that they do that, the snake village. He gave me a video of it. And they just, the kids are around it and everything, and they tapped the snake, the snake will strike out, and I'm thinking, my goodness. He went to the chief, and that's what you got to do to go into these villages, and asked the chief, he witnessed to him, and then asked the chief if he could teach in the village. This village is an isolated village. It does not want people around, visitors, but the chief allowed him to teach the children. And so he's been teaching the children, and gradually the parents are coming to listen. In fact, I have a picture now. The chieftain is coming to listen to the preaching. They have eight souls have gotten saved so far. and I believe a church will be planted there. I told Brother Rakesh he wants me to come and visit him, and I said, you get rid of the snakes and I'll come. I said, but you're not going to see me before then. So he's got a lot of work to do before I get there, I'll tell you that right now. He's a little hard to understand, but I think he's worth your listening to. He speaks fast. He does speak English. It's kind of a little hard, but I think it'll be a blessing to you if you want it to be. So go ahead and let's show that, and you can listen to him.
Praise the Lord. All glory to God. My name is Rakesh Kumar Gupta. I was born and brought up in a Hindu Orthodox family, and my father is a strict in Hindu, and they hate Christianity. And my father is a businessman. My mother is a housewife, and two brothers, they are also doing a business. My father is a well-learned, educated, and well-reputed in the town. And they hate Christianity. They say that it is a foreign religion. I really thank my family that they have helped me in studying Bachelor of Commerce. As I graduated in 2010, I was working in marketing company and did some business as my job. As usual, in 2014, at the end of December, I used to hang around with my childhood friend, and I saw something different in his life, and he became a Christian, and he has accepted Jesus Christ, and he shared me gospel. For the first time, I heard about Jesus Christ, gospel, good news, and he told me very little, and he gave me a Bible tract to read, John 3:16. And later on, 2015, some of the church members, they visited me and they share their life journey in Christ, how they have changed and forsaken the idolatries. And I was believing that all God is same, but day by day I was learning and started knowing the differences between them. And one day a preacher asked me, Rakesh, are you 100% sure if you die today, will you go to heaven? By hearing this question, Holy Spirit convicted in my heart to accept Jesus Christ. At that point also, I was not yet converted. And as my parents, they live in an Indo-Bhutan area, my parents and one preacher came from Bethlehem Baptist Church, Dimapur, Nagaland, in Indo-Bhutan area, and he shared me Bible, shared from the Bible, the gospel, the good news, and Romans Road. And till that time also, I was not yet born again. And but in my heart, I was a curiosity to learn. And I went hidingly to the Bible college and without telling anyone, and to know more about Jesus Christ. And as a Hindu, I went to Bible college, and later on in 2015 July, when pastor was preaching the gospel about Jesus Christ, I remember the date, that 17 July, I kneeled down and I asked Jesus to come into my heart, and I accepted Jesus Christ 100%, and I surrendered my life and gave my life to him. And on 2nd August 2015, I was baptized. And after college, I came back in my home. My father was very angry with me, and he told me that you have become a well-learned mad person. And he used to see all the in my pocket that I used to carry a Bible tracts to give out to the people. And he was telling me that by giving a Bible tracts, your stomach will be filled. And in this way, they did not help me and support me to study in Bible college. But thank God that that God has helped me to contact with Dr. Peter Thumai. And right now, I have finished my MTH in Master Theology from Baptist Graduate School of Theology and Mission in Dimapur, Nagaland, which is run by Dr. Peter Thumai. And he helped me to study there under work scholarship. And I'm also got engaged with a God-fearing girl and waiting for my graduation. But due to lockdown pandemic, COVID-19, our graduation and marriage program has been postponed. And right now, at this point of time also, I am right in mission field in Siliguri. And here I am teaching the children. Now there are around more than 60 children and visiting the houses and telling about the love of Jesus Christ. And I know that God has called me to be a church planter and in Uttar Pradesh, in Lucknow. And in Uttar Pradesh is a state where 200 million population is there, and there is a great persecution and challenges are there. And in that place, there is 0.07% of Christianity, and there is a great opportunity to share gospel also. And please pray for me, and also for the souls in Uttar Pradesh. And I will be not going home, but I will be going in mission field. Thank you.
Just to give a little update to him, this was made in 2020, and he was, of course, not graduated yet, but he did graduate in 2020, and he did get married. And the good news is, even though his parents have disowned him, when he got married, they came to the wedding. So that was a good thing. Right now, he is up in Uttar Pradesh, as I said, and he is church planting up there, working with those snakes, not trying to convert the snakes, mind you, but trying to ask the Lord to convert those people. And so you pray for him. Very interesting man. I have really enjoyed working with him, and I look forward to getting back up there maybe after all the snakes are cleared out, amen, and that whole village comes to the Lord. By the way, the exciting thing about this, in a lot of places, villages are coming to the Lord. I mean, not just a few, but many. And praise the Lord for that. Well, I got excited coming back to church tonight. You know, I like to wander around in a building, and Pastor gave me a tour. You got a beautiful building here, great potential, and boy, your plans sound really great and exciting. And tonight I just kind of walked around on my own, and I got really excited, and I walked in the kitchen because I saw 3 Keurig coffee pots. I thought, man, that is a really great sign of a great church. Amen. All righty. Just to give a little update, that beautiful lady in my picture was that girl that said, sure, you can see me in church. She is the one. I always forget to mention that. And, you know, by the way, if I come with my wife, and I hope I do, amen, but when I come back with my wife, try not to mention that part of my testimony. She gets a little disturbed with me about that, all right? If she was here, I wouldn't have told that. Oh, this is a... Well, she don't know where I am. No, amen. Okay, amen. Take your Bibles tonight. We have a few verses we want to look up. I'd like to do what we did this morning. Turn with me to 1 John chapter 5. 1 John chapter 5. I forgot my water. Let's see. It's right down in that pew behind you. Can you grab me my water, brother? And then when you find 1 John 5, if you put a marker in there, then turn to Romans chapter 1. So 1 John, oh, I'm sorry, wait a minute. Turn to Hebrews chapter 11. We'll go back in order. So 1 John 5, Hebrews chapter 11. And when you get to Hebrews 11, if you'd put a marker in there, that would be great. We'll turn to it in just a few minutes. And then the next verse would be Romans chapter 1. So 3 places tonight with markers, 1 John 5, Hebrews chapter 11, and Romans chapter 1. Our text tonight is going to be in Joshua chapter 3. 1 John 5, Romans chapter 1, Hebrews chapter 11, and our text is Joshua chapter 3. Joshua chapter 3. This evening, by the grace of God, I'd like to stir up in your hearts a very important word. A word that is to be active and alive in your life if you're going to please God. If you're going to walk with God, this word must be active and alive. It's a word that's essential if we're going to do God's will and be pleasing in what we do. And it's a word that's a must to see God do great and mighty things in our life. And by the way, whatever God does is a great and mighty thing, amen? But this word is essential to see God do that. The word appears 232 times in the New Testament and only 2 times in the Old Testament, and I'll tell you why later. And with that all in mind, let's go to Joshua chapter 3. And let me give you a little background to our text here. The Israelites are finally back to the Jordan River and are about ready to cross the river to go into the promised land and conquer it according to the commandment of God. Joshua is preparing the people to do that. And if you drop down to verse 5, that's where I'd like to start reading tonight. The Bible says, "And Joshua said to the people, sanctify yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders among you." Could I just say that God is still doing wonders among his people? "And Joshua spake unto the priests, saying, take up the Ark of the Covenant and pass over before the people. And they took up the Ark of the Covenant and went before the people. The Lord said to Joshua, this day will I begin to magnify thee in the sight of all Israel, that they may know that as I was with Moses, so I will be with thee. And thou shalt command the priests that bear the Ark of the Covenant, saying, when you are come to the brink of the water of Jordan, ye shall stand still in Jordan. And Joshua said unto the children of Israel, come hither, and hear the words of the Lord your God. And Joshua said, hereby ye shall know that the living God is among you." And by the way, the word that we're going to talk about tonight is a key to know that the living God is among you. "And that he will without fail drive out before you the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Hivites and the Perizzites and the Girgashites and the Amorites and the Jebusites. Behold, the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord of all the earth passeth over before you into Jordan. Now therefore take you 12 men out of the tribes of Israel, out of every tribe of man. And it shall come to pass, as soon as the soles of the feet of the priests that bear the Ark of the Lord of all the earth, shall rest in the waters of Jordan, that the waters of Jordan shall be cut off from the waters that come down from above, and they shall stand upon a heap. And it came to pass, when the people removed from their tents to pass over Jordan, and the priests bearing the Ark of the Covenant before the people, and as they that bear the Ark were come unto Jordan, and the feet of the priests that bear the Ark were dipped in the brim of the water, for Jordan overfloweth all his banks all the time of harvest, that the waters which came down from above stood and rose up upon a heap very far from the city Adam, that is beside Zeratin, and those that came down toward the sea of the plain, even the salt sea, failed and were cut off, and the people passed over right against Jericho. And the priests that bear the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord stood firm on the dry ground in the midst of Jordan, and all the Israelites passed over on dry ground until all the people were passed clean over Jordan." Now quickly, chapter 4, verse 15. "And the Lord spake unto Joshua, saying, command the priests that bear the Ark of the Testimony that they come up out of Jordan. Joshua therefore commanded the priests, saying, come ye up out of Jordan. And it came to pass, when the priests that bear the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord were come up out of the midst of the Jordan, and the soles of the priests' feet were lifted up onto the dry ground, that the waters of Jordan returned unto their place and flowed over all the banks as they did before." Let's pray. Father, I want to thank you so much for the opportunity to be here at this great church. I want to thank you, dear Lord, for the hospitality of the church. I want to thank you for the friendliness. I want to thank you, Father, for the good fellowship I've had with them. And Lord, as we get into the Word of God tonight, we just need to hear from you. Lord, I'm so thankful that you have taught us to assemble together like this so faithfully every week. We thank you for this opportunity tonight to come back. And I pray as we get into the Word of God and study this very important word in our life, that we would allow the Holy Spirit to work in our hearts concerning the application of the word. And Father, if there's some encouragement tonight, may we be encouraged. If there's some instruction tonight, may we be instructed. And if there's some correction tonight that we need, may we let you correct us. We love you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, whenever we think of Israel crossing the Jordan River into the land of Canaan, we think of the miracle of God dividing that river. According to our text, we're told two times that the banks were overflowing. I don't know if you've ever been to the river when the water is high and it's starting to come over the banks. It's a very frightening and intimidating thing. I live in a place called Schoharie Valley, Middleburg, New York. There was what was called the Schoharie River that really looked like a creek until it rained and rained and rained and rained, and it became a raging river that overflowed its bank and flooded the valley. Our church got flooded out twice. It was a very intimidating thing. We're also told two times that they crossed on dry ground. I don't know about you, but when I think of crossing, with the water being removed like that and crossing, I would think the land would be muddy, wouldn't you? But it was dry ground. Two times we were told they crossed on dry ground. And when you look at the whole thing, you must say, my, what a mighty work of God. Amen? What a mighty work of God. And all through the book of Joshua, we see the mighty hand of God at work again and again, enabling the Israelites to conquer the kingdom of the land. I might remind you that their army was a weak army. It was not a very impressive army. As a matter of fact, the armies of the kingdoms of Canaan were much greater than theirs. Do you remember what those fathers reported? We're like grasshoppers before them, and they have mighty armies, and they'll destroy our children. Their army was a weak army, but they had the God as their general, and the armies of the land of Canaan were no match for the God of Israel. Oh, how the Lord promised Israel of his presence and of his power. He said in Deuteronomy 3:22, you should not fear them, for the Lord your God, he shall fight for you. He said in Deuteronomy 20, verse 4, for the Lord your God is he that goeth with you to fight for you against your enemies and to save you. You know, I think at times we need to be reminded of the mighty power of our God. That the God of the Old Testament is the same God today. That the God of the Gospels is the same God today. That the God of the book of Acts is the same God today. You know, sometimes in reading the mighty acts of God in the Old Testament or the Gospels or the book of Acts, we sometimes have this tendency to think, well, that was then and this is now, and God doesn't work that way today. And what we do with that thinking, we limit what God can do in our life. Not what he is able to do, but what he can do in our life. I know the book of Joshua belongs to a different dispensation. It's called the dispensation of the law. And by the way, aren't you glad you live under grace and not law? I don't know about you. I always read my Bible through every year. I tell you what, I get into that law and all those different things they had. I'm so glad I'm not under the law. Yeah. Amen. And I understand that this is a time of the law. But I think we need to remember the words of the prophet Jeremiah that he spoke concerning God and concerning all dispensations. He said in Deuteronomy 32:17, all Lord God, behold, thou hast made the heaven and the earth by thy great power and stretched out arm, and there is nothing too hard for thee. I think we need to remember the words of the Lord God spoken back to Jeremiah in that very same chapter in verse 27. He said this, behold, I am the Lord, the God of all flesh. Is anything too hard for me? And of course, the answer to that is no. I think we need to remember the words of the angel Gabriel spoken to Mary when she asked, how shall this be, seeing I know not a man? And he said, the Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the highest shall overshadow thee. And then he said this, for with God, nothing shall be impossible. I think we need to remember the words Lord Jesus spoken to his disciples in reference to the rich man entering into heaven. He said, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for the rich to enter the kingdom of God. But then he said this, but with God, all things are possible. And brethren, if that's your God tonight, if you're saved, that is your God tonight. That is your God. That is your God whom you know and love and serve through the Holy Spirit. And when he is in what you are doing, nothing is too hard for you because nothing is too hard for our God. When he is in what you are doing, nothing is impossible to you because nothing is impossible with God. When he is in what you are doing, all things are possible to you because all things are possible with God. But I must draw your attention to what allowed God to do this great miracle of dividing the Jordan. Not enabled him to do it, but what allowed him to do it. If you go back to verse 14 of our text, please. Go back to Joshua 5, rather. And drop down to verse 14. And look at me, and right there we're told what allowed God to do that. Joshua chapter 3, and drop down to verse 14. It came to pass, when the people removed their tents to pass over Jordan, and the priests bearing the ark of the covenant before the Lord, before the people, and as they that bear the ark were come unto Jordan, and the feet of the priests that bear the ark were dipped in the brim of the water, for Jordan overfloweth all his banks at the time of harvest, that the waters which came down from above stood and rose up upon a heap very far from the city of Adam, that is beside Zeraton. And those that came down toward the sea of the plain, even the salt sea, failed and were cut off, and the people passed over right against Jericho. Now, do you see it? Do you see what allowed God to do that miracle? It was the faith of Israel. It was the faith of Israel. It was the faith of the priest who were told to go to that river where the banks were overflowing and the water was flowing down. And they were commanded to put their feet in the water, and then God would divide that Red Sea. It was the faith of Israel that allowed God to do that miracle. And as you read through the book of Joshua, you find that every great work that God did, even standing still the universe for a whole day, was done by the faith of Israel, by the faith of God's people. 40 years ago, they were at this very same spot as children. Some of them were probably infants. Others were maybe toddlers and maybe some young children there, maybe their teens or what have you, or maybe younger. And if you remember the story, the fathers, they sent 12 spies into the promised land to check it out, to see if it's all that God said it would be. And by the way, if you read on that situation, you will find that God did not order that. That's what they wanted to do, and God let them do it. And they went in there and spied that land. It was everything God said it was. And then they came back and they said, oh, it's more than what God said it was. But remember those 10 spies? Oh, the people are big there, and we're like grasshoppers, and they'll destroy our children. There's no way we can do it. Now, there's two that said we can. That was Joshua and Caleb. But that 10 poisoned the multitudes, and they said, we can't do it. And God said, okay, then go back to the wilderness and wander for 40 years, and I'll give it to your children. And I want to tell you something about these children now that are adults and are leading Israel. They learned something over those 40 years. They learned to trust God for what he said he would do. And if they would trust God for what he said he would do, then God would do it. Faith is a word I want to talk about tonight. Oh, that's such an important word in our life. But we're not talking about any faith, are we? We're talking about faith in particular. We're talking about Bible faith, faith in God and his word. When I got saved, I gave my testimony this morning as a teenager graduating from high school. The cult that I was brought up in is what's called Christian Science. I wasn't real serious about it. As a matter of fact, I always complained to mother when she took me to church, you know, and finally at the age of 13, she said, all right, you don't have to go anymore. But if you asked me what I was a Christian Scientist. Boy, it sounded professional, amen, Christian Scientist. Someone asked me, well, what's a Christian Scientist? Confusion. And it's not Christian, it's not science. But nevertheless, my grandmother is what's called a practitioner. And you say, what are they? Well, I hate to say that, they're kind of like a pastor, but they don't preach or teach. But they're the ones that you would call if you broke your arm and they try to convince you it wasn't broken. Or if you burned your thumb, they would try to convince you it's really not hurting. Mind over matter. Well, I went to grandmother all excited and I got saved. And I gave my testimony to her. And here's what she said. Oh, John, I'm so happy for you. As long as you have faith in God, it doesn't matter what you believe about God, just as long as you have faith. Let me tell you something. There's a faith in God that's a devil's lie that leads to eternal hell, and there'll be many that are on it, amen? And then there's a Bible faith whose author is God, praise the Lord, that offers his forgiveness of our sins and eternal life and a home in heaven. And when does that Bible faith begin? The moment we put faith in Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. The moment we trust him for God's forgiveness of our sins and eternal life, we're born again, a child of God by the Holy Spirit. That's when that faith begins. And brethren, when that faith is born in your heart, the day you believe the gospel, praise God, it's still there. Still there. But it's there with purpose. It's there to see God do great and mighty things for his glory. Was it not a great and mighty thing that he saved you? Weren't you excited about that? Did you not call that a miracle? Well, brethren, the miracles are not to end. God has birthed that faith in your life with purpose, with program, to see God do great and mighty things. You see, Bible faith is not just a past experience of salvation that we give testimony of, though I like to hear testimonies of salvation. By the way, it's a great soul-winning tool. Just share your faith with someone. Share with someone how you got saved. Amen. But it's not just a past experience of salvation. Rather, it's to be a now, everyday activity that makes God, whom we cannot see nor touch, just as real as the person sitting next to us. And it's a prerequisite by which to see God do great things. In fact, to see God do the impossible. Quickly, Matthew chapter 17. Will you turn there with me? I didn't have you mark this one. But Matthew chapter 17. In this chapter, the father had a devil-possessed son that he was bringing to Jesus to have the Lord cast that devil out of his son. When he got there, Jesus was not there. The Lord was on the Mount Transfiguration with James and Peter and John. But hey, he had the other disciples. He had second best. So he brought them to the disciples, told the problem, and they tried everything they could to cast that demon out of that boy. I suspect that they laid their hands on him just like Jesus would lay their hands on him. I suspect they probably said the words they thought the Lord would have said, but for some reason that devil could not come out of that boy. And then Lord Jesus comes down the mountain. He goes running unto the Lord Jesus, and he said, he told him the situation, and then he said, if you can do anything. Now, that's interesting, because when he first came to him, he knew the Lord could do that. Can I say something to you? This is not part of my message. I need to keep on course, amen? But you better watch who you hang around. They can kill your zeal for the Lord. They can kill your zeal for your church. They can even kill your zeal for your preacher. You better make sure you hang around. They love Jesus, and they love the word. Amen. But he got discouraged with these disciples, but he ran to the Lord. He said, if you can do anything, would you cast this devil out of my son? And the Lord said, if thou believe anything, it's possible to him that believeth. And then, of course, he said, Lord, help my unbelief. And the Lord cast the devil out. Well, he got along with the disciples. And look at verse 19. Then came the disciples of Jesus apart and said, why could we not cast him out? And Jesus said to them, because of your unbelief. Because of your unbelief. For verily I say unto you, if you have faith as a grain of a mustard seed, you shall say unto this mountain, remove hence to yonder place, and it shall remove, and nothing shall be impossible unto you. Why is it nothing shall be impossible unto you? Because nothing is impossible unto God. And when he is in what you are doing, nothing is impossible for you. And we need to understand, if we don't already, but there are some impossible things that the Lord would have us to do for his glory, that he would do through us and for us, but if only we would trust him to do it. If only we would trust him to do it. Go over to Mark chapter 11 and drop down to verse 21 with me. Here we have the story of the Lord Jesus taking the disciples to the temple and clean it out. And on his way, he comes across this fig tree and he goes to it and there's no fruit on it. He curses it and it withers. In verse 21, it says, and Peter, calling to remember it, said to him, Master, this is the next morning on their way back to the temple. Master, behold, the fig tree which thou cursed is withered away. And Jesus answering said unto them, have faith in God. Have faith in God. For verily I say unto you that whosoever shall say to this mountain, be thou removed and be thou cast in the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. And brethren, when God's in what you're doing, there is nothing too hard for you, because nothing's too hard for the Lord. And there are some hard things that God desires to do for you and through you if only you'll trust him to do it. Now, go back with me to one chapter, to Mark chapter 10, and let's look at blind Bartimaeus. He's the one that heard this commotion and asked what was going on, and he said, oh, the master's passing by. And he cried out to him, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. Disciples said, be quiet. He's had a hard day. Don't bother him. But he cried all the more, and the Lord called him over. And in verse 51, the Bible says, and Jesus answered and said to him, what wilt thou that I should do unto thee? The blind man said to him, Lord, that I might receive my sight. And Jesus said unto him, go thy way. Now watch this. Thy faith hath made thee whole. Thy faith had made thee whole. And immediately he received his sight, and he vowed Jesus in the way. And I have a question for you tonight. I had one this morning, got one for you tonight. What has thy faith seen God do since you've been saved? What has thy faith seen God do since you've been saved? Go back to Matthew chapter 9, and we have two blind men following Jesus in verse 27. Matthew 9, verse 27. And we read in Matthew 9, verse 27, when Jesus departed thence, two blind men followed him, crying and saying, Thou son of David, have mercy on us. Verse 28, and when he was come into the house, the blind men came to him, and Jesus saith unto them, Believe ye that I'm able to do this? They said unto him, Yea, Lord. Then touch ye their eyes, saying, According to your faith, be it unto you. And there's many more accounts are found throughout the Gospels and even the book of Acts, describing the mighty works of God because of man's faith in God to do them. And so I ask again, Christian, what have you seen God do according to your faith since you've been saved? What have you seen God do according to your faith since you have been saved? What is your faith expecting God to do? What faith do you have tonight that you're trusting God to do in His time? What are you expecting God to do according to your faith? A believer's faith and the mighty works of God, they go together. And we'll not see God do many great things in the midst of His people if we don't trust God to do many great things. We all know the story of the Lord Jesus going back to His village where He was brought up. And the Bible says in Matthew 13:57, they were offended in Him. But Jesus said to them, A prophet's not without honor, save in his own country, in his own house. And He did not many mighty works there because of their unbelief. Now, I realize we take that and apply it to the unbeliever, but wait a minute. I fear there's not many mighty works of God being done in many of our churches today because of a lack of faith in God among His people for what He said He would do if only we would trust Him to do it. I've been on the road a lot since 2017. I get into a lot of churches. I hear preachers say it's not like it used to be. We're not seeing decisions for the Lord like we used to see. Our churches aren't as full as they used to be. They're not walking the aisle like they used to. I've been in churches where they do little soul winning. Some have given up on going door to door soul winning. And yet the Bible says in Romans chapter 1 verse 16, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. For it's the power of God and the salvation to everyone that believeth, the Jew first and also to the Greek. That's a faith verse. That verse will only work if you put trust in God to do that. We have Matthew 28, verse 18, where Jesus said, all power is given me in heaven and earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them. He didn't say, and should they get saved? He said, baptizing them. In other words, if we'll just stay true to the work of God by faith, God will give the increase. It's a promise, but it's got to be done by faith. Amen. What has your faith seen God do since you've been saved? Think about that. Much? Little? Anything? What's your faith trusting God to do today, right now, in His time, but you're trusting God to do it? Go over to me to Romans chapter 1. You should have that marked. And look at verse 17 with me. Romans 1, verse 17, it says, For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as written, The just shall live by faith. God underlined that. The just shall live by faith. The just are God's children, amen, who've been saved by faith in Jesus Christ as Savior. And after we're saved, we're to live with God by faith every day for what He will do for His glory. Go over to 1 John chapter 5. 1 John chapter 5, that should be marked as well in your Bible. We know the verse. It says, For whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. That's a present tense verse. That's today. We're to overcome. Born of God, that's believers. That's you and I. Overcometh means to prevail, to get the victory. And how does a believer overcome the world? And this is a victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. In other words, we are to walk by faith in Jesus every day of our life. We are to expect the Lord Jesus to open up the Word of God to us and show us things that He will do for us and through us if only we'll trust Him to do it. Our life is to be full of faith promises. And so I ask you again, what has your faith seen God do since you have been saved? Bible faith is not passive, but active. It's to be alive in your life, trusting God today for what God said He will do. Let me just give you quickly three facts about Bible faith that will allow God to do great and mighty things in our life. Three facts, and I wish you'd write them down. Number one is the character of Bible faith. By character, I mean definition. What is Bible faith? Well, I define Bible faith this way, and there may be a better definition, but to me, Bible faith is trusting God according to His Word to do something for me or through me. Trusting God according to His Word to do something for me or through me. In other words, you have God's Word on what you're trusting God to do in your life. John 17, 17, the Lord said to the Father, sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. Romans 10, 17, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. You know, when I moved down south, that was a big move for me. I loved my church where I was pastoring, but I went by faith. I knew that God had called me from the word of God to go down and be the pastor of Grace Baptist Church. When I surrendered to going to help ministries, that was a great step for me as well in my later years of life, to step by the security of being a pastor and having that secure income coming in every week and all the benefits that went to my position. And I had to give all that up. And the only reason I gave it up was because God taught me that I need to give it up and trust Him to take care of me. And so I had to step out by faith. And I'll tell you what, that was a battle. Amen. But turn to Hebrews chapter 11 with me, and I want to give you a Bible definition of faith. Here's what a Bible definition of faith is. You can't improve on the Bible. Amen. Here's what it says. Now faith, verse 1, is a substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Let's go through that again. Faith is a substance. You know what that means? It's the reality. It's the assurance. It's the promise. It's a confidence. And then it says of things. Isn't that interesting? It doesn't say thing. It says things, plural, many things. Listen, brethren, there's many faith promises that God has in His Word that He desires to show you to trust Him for. Things. And then it goes on, hope for, expected. That word hope is so used different in our Bible than the way we use it today. I could tell Pastor, well, I hope to be there next week. That's not a sure thing. I want to be there and probably will be, but we're not sure. But in the Bible, when you read of hope, it's an expectation. It's a promise. It's going to happen. So faith is a substance, a confidence of things hoped for, expected. It's the evidence. It's a proof of things. There's that plural again. Not seen. Not yet done. Not yet received, but will be in His time. Bible faith is your confidence in God for what He will do for you or through you according to His word now. In His time, but today. It's a proof for what He will do for you and through you in His time. If only you will trust Him to do it, you have God's word on it. And brethren, our lives should be filled with faith promises. Oh, listen, as we read the word of God, God will give us faith promises. As a pastor preaches, God will give faith promises. As a Sunday school teacher teaches, God will give faith promises. As we have a devotional relationship with the Lord, God will give us faith promises that He wants us to trust Him for, to do whether it be for us or through us in His time. But there's faith promises. Amen. Now, look at Hebrews chapter 11 with me again. It's interesting. I said in the beginning of my message, only two times do we find the word faith in the Old Testament. That's it. Why is that? Because the Old Testament is full of testimonies of God's people walking with the Lord by faith and seeing God do the impossible. That's why. The Old Testament is an illustration of the New Testament truth that we're studying tonight. And for example, look at Hebrews chapter 11, verse 7. By faith, Noah, being warned of God of things not yet seen, or seen as yet, moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house. How did he do it, brethren? By faith. Faith in what? God's word. Amen? God's word. Verse 8. By faith, Abraham, when he was called to go out into a place which he should have to receive for inheritance, obeyed, and he went out, not knowing whither he went. How did he go? By faith. Faith in what? In God's word. How about verse 11? Through faith, also Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed and was delivered of a child when she was past age because she judged him faithful who had promised. I like that. That's a good definition of faith. Trusting God to be faithful who has promised. But wait a minute. Are we talking about the same Sarah? Isn't it the Sarah back in Genesis when the Lord visited Jesus and those two angels and he said that Sarah, who was beyond childbearing age would conceive, and wasn't she behind the tent and she laughed? And then the Lord asked, why does Sarah laugh? Is anything too hard for the Lord? Remember that? And then she tried to deny it. I wasn't. And he said, oh, yes, you were. You know, God knows us, amen? You can't get away with anything with God, amen? But here's what I want to point out to you. Somewhere from her unbelief, she went from unbelief to trusting God to do what he said he would do. And because of that faith, Isaac was born. I wonder what would have happened if Sarah never believed. I wonder. You know, anything we expect from God requires faith in God and his word for what we expect him to do. And anything we do for God requires faith in God and his word for him to do that through us. Well, so number one, the character of Bible faith, trusting in God according to his word to do something for us or through us. But then I want to see something else. The command of Bible faith, it's trust and obey. The command of Bible faith is obedience. Faith in God according to his word always requires obedience to God according to his word by his grace to see God do what he said he would do. Every faith promise has obedience to it. There's things that God expects us to do. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 7 again. By faith Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving his house. Why did Noah do that? Why did he prepare an ark? He never saw rain. He probably didn't understand all this water flooding the whole world. But yet he went and built an ark because God commanded him to do that. What would have happened if he never built that ark? How about Abraham there, verse 8? When he was called to go out into a place which he should have to receive for inheritance, he obeyed. Y'all have to underline that. Obeyed. And he went out not knowing whither he went. If you saw Abraham back then, you could have said, Abraham, where are you going? I don't know. I'm just going, trusting God to guide my feet. I'm obeying the Lord. And what we need to understand about Bible faith is that there's going to be commandments of the Lord. We are to walk with God by faith. We are to love him by obedience. And that will keep us on track for trusting God to do what he said he will do, if only we will trust him for doing it in his time. And then the third thing I want you to see here is a companion of Bible faith is persistent prayer. The companion of Bible faith is persistent prayer. Look back at Hebrews 11 with me quickly, verse 5. By faith Enoch was translated that he should not see death. And was not found because God had translated him, for before his translation, he had this testimony that he pleased God. Verse 6, but without faith, it's impossible to please him. Are you pleasing the Lord tonight? What has your faith seen God do in you and through you since you've been saved? What are you trusting God for today to do in his time, according to his word? But you're trusting his word for what he would do in his time. Without faith, it's impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Now, I think there's a lot of application in that verse, but one is certainly this, persistent prayer. Persistent prayer. Faith is not just knowing what God said he'll do according to his word. It's just not obeying the commandments of Christ by his grace. It's also asking and keep asking and trusting God to do what he said he will do until he does it. Until he does it. Believe in the promise of his word. Obey his word. Ask and keep asking for the promise of his word until God does what he said he would do. Now, I should have had you put a marker in there, but I must have you go back to Mark 11. Swing back there with me real quick. I read this to you earlier, that withered fig tree. Remember that? And the Lord said, have faith in God. Amen. He talked about, you know, whosoever shall say in this mountain, be thou removed and be thou cast in the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass. He shall have whatsoever he saith. Now, I purposely did not read 24 with you until this point. Look at verse 24. Therefore, based on everything he said, I say unto you, what things soever you desire when you pray, believe that you receive them, and ye shall have them. See, there's persistent prayer with our walk of faith. We need to keep asking until God does what he said he would do. Remember that poor man with his demon-possessed child? The disciple said, why could we not do it? Because of your unbelief. And then he said this, howbeit, this kind goeth not up but by prayer and fasting. Well, we don't do much fasting anymore, do we, in our churches? But yet that's part of persistent prayer. That's part of waiting upon God to do what he said he would do. When I got saved, my dad was one of these Lutherans that went to church Christmas and Easter, and to be quite frank with you, he didn't even go then, but he was a Lutheran. My mother was pretty faithful in taking me to her church and all my years of growing up as a child. When I got saved, I thought of that Philippian jailer, and thou shalt be saved in thy household. I was living at home at the time, and so I thought, I'm going to pray for my folks to get saved. I want to tell you what, it was a battle praying for them. To be quite frankly, there was times I quit praying for them, but I had to get back to praying for their salvation again, basing on that promise of the Philippian jailer to his house. Can I say something? Can I give a good report? My dad got cancer at 61. I had a call I was in Tennessee Temple in summer school. I had a call that if I wanted to see dad alive, I need to come home. So I flew back home from Tennessee Temple up to New York, and I'd never seen dad so scared in my life. I've just never seen him like that. He was in that hospital. And so I went through the gospel with him, and I said, Dad, wouldn't you like to accept? I said, have you ever heard that before? And he said, well, I heard it when I was growing up as a Lutheran. And I said, well, did you ever accept the Lord as your Savior? And he said, no. I said, would you like to do it tonight and get that peace in your heart? No. Let me think about it. Dad started getting better, and I went back home. It looked like he was starting to turn around. But then I got a call that he got worse. And I called the pastor who did our marriage ceremony and asked me to go see my dad. So he went to the hospital, and dad was in the bed with a tube down him and eyes closed, and the pastor went through the plan of salvation with him. And he called me that night, and he said, John, your dad sat up all day. He was tired. I don't know if he heard a word I said, but I still gave the gospel, and I prayed with him. 2 days later, he died. I had peace in my heart that he was going to go home to the farm. And I couldn't understand why he died. I couldn't put that together. When I came home, I went to the bedroom to see my mother. She said to me, John, your dad wanted me to tell you something. You know the day that pastor came in to see your dad? Yeah. Well, next morning, I went to see him. He motioned for me to give him the chalkboard. He said, tell John I heard everything that the pastor said. He said, what does that mean? That means my dad got saved. My mother was stubborn. She had such a nice way of cutting me off when I tried to give the gospel. One day at the age of 91, I was visiting, and once again I tried. I said, Mom, are you afraid to die? She said, well, of course I'm afraid to die. You know, I said, you don't have to be. Can I share the gospel with you? She said, go ahead. I went through the whole planet. She never shut me off. I got down to the very end of it. And I said, now, wouldn't you like to accept Christ as your Savior and have peace in your heart and know that when you leave, you're going to be with him in heaven? And she said, yes. I said, what? She said, yes. And she prayed with me and accepted Christ as her Savior. You know, I'm so glad that Jesus doesn't require perfection from us. He just requires perfecting. And I must confess to you, there's times when I gave up on mom and dad. I didn't think they're going to get saved, but then I went back to praying again for them. Just keep claiming that promise, and God came through, and they got saved. Persistent prayer. Persistent prayer. There's another side of my testimony. And I'm not going to get into it with you because it's none of your business. But I can look back at my ministry of 37 years and see some things that God wanted to do for me and through me that I started by faith, but then I quit praying and I forgot about it and God didn't do it. You know, I wonder how many things are in our lives tonight that God would have done if we just kept walking with him by faith, obeying his commandments, and just keep asking until he does what he said he would do. I wonder how many things we might have in our lives that didn't happen because we quit trusting. I'll close with this. I love the story of that man that brought his son to the Lord. He came with confidence, and his confidence got shook by the disciples. And he said, "Lord, if you can do anything, cast this devil on my son." And the Lord said, "If you believe, anything is possible to him that believeth." Remember that? How many remember that? I'll make you turn to it if you don't remember it. Okay? And then he said this, and I love it. He said, "Lord, I believe. Help thou my unbelief." And I want to tell you something. In a walk of faith, there's going to be challenges. There's going to be hardships that will come our way. There's going to be writing on the wall that will say it will never happen. And all there's going to be a struggle to just keep trusting God. We might just not trust him for a season. But I'm so thankful that he knows we believe, and he'll help our unbelief if we'll just come back and trust him for what he said he'll do. I want to close tonight by asking that question again. I think it's a fair question. What has your faith seen God do in your life since you've been saved? We ought to be able to stand up one after another and give testimonies of the mighty things God has done in our life. Because of his word, because that's where it comes from. That's your anchor, the Bible. Because of his word, and you're trusting him according to his word. What has your faith seen God do since you've been saved? And what is your faith trusting God to do today in his time? Father, thank you so much for our study tonight. Lord, what a subject. I am so thankful that for by grace are we saved through faith, and that not of ourselves. It's a gift of works. It's a gift, not of works, lest any man should boast. I'm so thankful that we met you through faith, and that faith was birthed in our life with purpose and with promise. That, Father, you desire to still show thyself great in our life with mighty works. Every work you do is great and mighty. But, Father, you've also taught us that we will only see that mighty works if we'll let the word of God speak to us to show us what you'll do, and then we'll trust and obey and pray. And, God, many things in our life, according to your word, will pass from faith to sight. Father, could there be some people here tonight that came perhaps forgetting something that they were once trusting God to do according to the word? Perhaps they got distracted or just discouraged, thinking it'll never happen. Could they be encouraged tonight to come back to you like that father did? "Lord, I believe, help thou my unbelief." Just get back to trusting you and praying that you'll do what you said you'll do in your time. Could it be we have people living here tonight without even one faith promise in their life? They're just living by sight, trusting this world for their needs, going day by day, just living for the things of this world and not for the excitement of a walk with God by faith. May they be convicted and encouraged tonight to be determined to walk by faith in God's word. Lord, you have your way. If there's someone here not saved tonight, oh, Father, I pray tonight they would realize that they're playing with fire. And if they die, it will be an eternal fire of hell. That they might come to you tonight by faith. The only way we can come to you, Lord Jesus, is by faith and put trust in you for your forgiveness of our sins and eternal life. Thank you, dear God. Stir our faith tonight, Father. Stir our love for the word of God. Stir our expectation that we might read the Bible, expecting God to give us faith promises. And then by obedience and persistent prayer, see those faith promises pass from hope to sight. Oh God, what you do with a church that's on fire, to see God do the impossible, the hard things, all things that are possible with you. We thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. Pastor.
Amen. Let's stand together tonight and let's take our hymn book and turn to page number 391. 391. And let's sing a couple verses of invitation, standing and asking the Lord to work in our hearts. There's great faith and there's small faith. There's strong faith and there's weak faith. And strong faith comes when we look to the promises. Weak faith comes when we're focused on the problems. And God help us to be strong in faith, giving glory to God. Amen. And what a great challenge. And he said it right. Stir our hearts. And I hope our hearts have been stirred tonight through the preaching of the Word of God. Let's sing this wonderful hymn, Trust and Obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. We'll sing a couple verses. If you'd like to pray and use the altar, you pray tonight, talk to the Lord. Listen, the preaching of God's Word is designed for us to make decisions, not just to, you know, hear and do nothing about it, but we're to respond to the Word of God. And so if you need to make a decision tonight, make a decision and ask the Lord to do something in your life. Let's sing out on that first. When we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on our way while we do His good will. Amen. And with all who will trust and not a shadow can rise, not a cloud in the sky. Not a doubt nor a fear, not a sigh nor a tear can abide while we trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no then in fellowship sweet, we will sit at His feet. His sign in the way, what He says we will do, where He sends we will go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey. Quoted these verses tonight, but whenever we talk about faith, there's always two verses that just blow my mind away. And one is in Matthew 13, verse 58, where the Bible says, and He could not do there many mighty works, and He could not do many mighty works there because of their unbelief. And just to think on what we're missing out on because of our lack of faith. And, you know, in Psalm chapter number 78, the people of Israel, they actually asked this question, witnessing all the things that they witnessed in the wilderness wanderings. They asked this question, can God furnish a table in the wilderness? I mean, their sin was not the fact that they were hungry. Their sin was not the fact that they were thirsty. Their sin was that they doubted for one millisecond that God could provide and take care of their needs. And as a result of their unbelief, an entire generation died. The Bible says their carcasses rotted in the wilderness. It's just amazing to think about what we miss out because of our lack of faith. And then the other verse is in Hebrews 11, verse 6, which he mentioned, but without faith it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. We can't please God apart from faith, living faith. And God help us, amen. And it seems like the closer we get to the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now remember, the rapture is the blessed hope, isn't it? It's the blessed hope. And every day, we're at least one day closer to his return. But it seems like the closer we're getting to Christ's return, the more timid, the more fearful, the more frightened. It seems like Christians are withering away. And Jesus said in Luke chapter number 18, when the Lord comes, shall he find faith on the earth? And so, I tell you, I think a lot of the root problems that we're having, the root problem for a lot of the issues that we're dealing with in our spiritual lives is unbelief, is lack of faith. And I think if we can get a hold of this principle of faith that is taught throughout Hebrews 11, that's why I'm going to be preaching more about it on Sunday mornings, it would transform every area of our lives. Do you know why I come to church? Well, I'm the pastor, but we've been going to church faithfully for all these years because the Bible tells us to do it, and living faith obeys God's word. And the reason why we try to use our monies as Christians in a way that honors and pleases God, because we know at some point we're going to stand before the Lord and give an account of our stewardship. And it transforms every area of our lives. And so, great challenge tonight, and I hope your hearts were stirred. Be sure to stop. Brother Mills is in the foyer, and greet him and thank him for being here, and be praying for the ministry, for Help Ministries. And I was talking to him today about some trips. He's going to Tanzania here in November, and then in the spring of next year, he'll be going to India. And we're thankful for all of that. We do have one missions letter real quick. Let's go ahead and, you know what? We'll push that off till next week. And having a missions theme this week, we'll go ahead and push it off for next week. All right, let's pray, and then we'll be dismissed. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the time that we've had tonight to hear the word of God preached. Thank you for how it was preached, the spirit in which it was given. And thank you, Lord, for how the plain, simple truth of your word convicts and challenge your people. And I pray that our hearts would, Lord, that the truth that we've heard tonight would be sealed in our hearts, that it would go further than the parking lot, that it would transform the way we live tomorrow and throughout this week. And I pray that you'd help us, Lord, to glorify and honor your holy name. And so bless us now. Dismiss us with your blessings. I pray once again for Brother Harvey, that you'd lay your hand upon him and touch his body. Raise him up, give him strength, we pray. We love you and thank you for loving us. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. God bless you.